Well, here we are to have a look at, not a guitar this time, but the Bible. What's it all about? It's a massive book. It's not impossible to read it. If you read 3 pages a day, you'll get through it in roughly 1 year. The Bible has been about for thousands of years, and it wasn't written by one person. It was written by many different people over centuries. We regard it as Christians as the inspired word of God, which means it's not dictated by God, apart from one or two very, very small sections, like the Ten Commandments, for instance. But the men who wrote it were inspired, were given the basics of the message that they were to convey. How they did it was up to them. If that wasn't the case, then it would read as if it was one author all the way through, but it's not. You get different personalities, different ways of phrasing things as it comes through. So there's a human element in the structure of the story. Now, it's split basically into two sections. This big thick bit here, if you can see that, that's known as the Old Testament. And that is basically the Jewish Bible. It starts with Genesis and it ends up with a wee book called Malachi. That was written over many, many centuries. After that, there was a 400-year silence. God did not speak to anyone for 400 years. And then you have the rest of the book, this wee bit here. Now, that's known as the New Testament, and that starts with the story of Jesus and carries through to the early days of the church and ends up with a few prophecies for the future. So, going through it book by book, what do we have? Well, with Genesis first of all, which is all the old familiar stories about the creation, the fall of man, the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, the flood, Tower of Babel. These are all crammed into the first 11 chapters. And a chapter in the Bible is very small. It might not even be an entire page. A page and a half is about as long as a chapter ever gets in the Bible. These are just the introduction, and you're not meant to wade into it to try and decide whether they're literal or not, fun though that is. You're really just meant to take the message out of it. We then continue into Genesis and we meet a character called Abraham, initially called Abram. It gets, like quite a few folk in the Old Testament, gets his name changed, which indicates a change of status before God, which of course is what Christianity is all about. It's changing your status from sinner to saved. Well, we meet Abram, and when you read it, it seems like a real character. This seems quite a plausible human being that you're reading about. One of the things that surprised me when I read the book the first time was that Abram and the others after him are not goody-goodies. I thought it was going to be all about how you should behave, but it's not. They're real people. They're flawed. Some of them are downright villains. But in each case, the villain becomes the goody. And it's the process of change that's all important throughout Scripture. And we'll keep coming back to that time and time again. Well, by the end of Genesis, Abram's descendants have legged it off to Egypt because of a famine. And that brings us to the book of Exodus, which is the coming out of Egypt. They had been there actually for some 400 years and were responsible for building the pyramids and other such things. Not all of them, but you know, the ones that happened in that time. They'd gone from friends of Egypt to slaves of Egypt. And God raises up Moses to deliver them. And he takes them out, heading back towards Canaan, the promised land where Abram had actually come from. That's modern day Israel. Well, they sent out some spies, quite wisely, ahead to have a wee look at Canaan. and they reported that it was a wonderful land, but the people were a foot taller than the average Hebrew, and the cities were all very heavily fortified. Mission Impossible said 10 of the spies, 2 of the spies said, "We can take these guys." Well, God was again disappointed, because the people had showed a lack of trust. Now, back in the Garden of Eden, that story is all about a lack of trust. In that story, man says to God, "No thanks, we don't trust you, we'll do it our way." And this is what is happening again as they approach the promised land. "No thanks, we don't trust you, we'll find another plan." Well, that generation wandered about for another 40, 50 years in the desert and died out. Until a new generation who did trust the Lord was raised, and they go in, and you have the walls of Jericho falling and all these other stories of battles that happen. Now, after that, there are 3 books, Leviticus, Numbers and Deuteronomy. Now, these are possibly the most boring books you'd ever read in your life. They cover ceremonial stuff, rituals, and the small print of the Ten Commandments. Yes, the lawyers got in early. There's all the little laws, which reading them now seem very outmoded and very draconian, but at the time they were actually very enlightened. The legal code that they had was very advanced for the day. Then we come to the book of Joshua, which is how they took the promised land. That's got some pretty interesting stories in it. It's quite a good read, as is the next book, which is the book of Judges. Monarchy had not occurred to them at this point, so they were governed by judges who were appointed by God, really, just to look after the people, shepherds looking after the flock, a familiar picture. And these judges were not all men. Some of them were women. Imagine that. Now, actually, for the centuries that we're talking about, that was incredibly advanced. We then come to a strange little book, the Book of Ruth. Won't take you long to read it, it's worth a read. A very human, touching little story. It's romantic, it's a love story. Ruth, it turns out, was not Jewish, and yet she is one of the ancestors of Jesus. Now, what this book says, apart from the obvious message that you'll get when you read it, kind of love and faithfulness are a good thing. The authors of the Bible are not trying to whitewash Jesus. If they were, they would never have included a book that said that his bloodline was impure. They would have, that would have been deleted. So it marks the overall honesty of what you're given here. We then have the books of 1 and 2 Samuel, about the first of the judges that we had. Now, you'll notice that doesn't seem to be in chronological order, does it? Well, the Bible's not too worried about chronology. In fact, by the time you get to the end of it, chronology has gone completely and utterly out the window. But that was the ancient mindset. They wrote the way a conversation would develop. If I talk about a battle, you mention a battle, and you say after the battle was a great party, so then I say something about the party, another party that we had, and a conversation develops like that. Ancient writings could tend to be like that as well. We then move on to 4 books, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, which basically cover much of the same material. This time, of course, it is the kings of Israel that they're talking about, the different rulers, because the people had got fed up with judges. They'd seen other countries with kings, and they thought, we want that as well. God said, bad idea, you'll regret it. But they said, no, 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 we want, this is what we want. God said, okay, fair enough, that's what you want, I'll give you a king. And he gave them King Saul. Now King Saul turned out to be a nutcase, absolute nutter. He was succeeded by David, who you may have heard of, the shepherd boy, who slew Goliath and was a minstrel. And we still use some of his lyrics. In fact, you can quite easily say that David is the most successful songwriter of all time, because 3,000 years after he wrote his lyrics, we're still singing them today, and people himself are still setting new tunes to his words. Beat that, Mr. McCartney. Right, where are we now? Yes, the stories of the kings. Well, basically, it's a story of decline. They start out quite well, and things go from bad to worse, and they fall away from God. God gives them several warnings. He raises up prophets to say, wait a minute, if you keep on going this way, it's going to be a disaster. These guys get ignored, and 10 of the tribes are invaded and captured by the Assyrians, carted off to who knows where. They are known as the Lost Tribes of Israel, because they are lost. And the two remaining tribes survive a wee bit longer, but then suffer the same fate at the hands of the Babylonians. After 70 years in exile in Babylon, Babylon itself falls to the upcoming power of Persia. Well, the new king, Cyrus, decides to repatriate everybody, not just the Jews that had happened to, all the captive people that made up the Babylonian Empire, because he wanted to break it up. Well, he sends them back, complete with all the treasures that had been looted, so it was actually quite a good outcome for them, and with orders to rebuild the temple. Which brings us to the next two books, which are Ezra and Nehemiah, and this is about this return from exile and the rebuilding of the temple. Up to this point, we've had great emphasis on the keeping of the law in the book here, the Ten Commandments in all the small print, and the way to righteousness was seen as keeping the law. That has a problem. What happens when human nature gets the better of you? In modern terms, you could be a terribly goody-goody person, never put a foot wrong, and you get into your car today, and as you're driving, you sneeze. And in the process of sneezing, you lose concentration, and you hit a child who's just stepped out in front of you. Where's all your goodness going? It's away. What that? It's gone completely. Well, relying on your own goodness is a fragile thing. You might make it, but you might not. And we'll see when Jesus comes along. He turns that round. Because remember, it was trust that was broken. It's trust that is required again. And the method to salvation is through faith. Faith implies trust. Right, now we come to the book of Job. And again, to show the mixed up chronology, the book of Job was the first one that was ever written down. It's the oldest book, and yet it's halfway through the Old Testament. Well, Job, we're talking about this righteousness thing. Job was a righteous man, and he was richly blessed. He was a millionaire in the terms of the day. He had flocks, and he had family and possessions. He was very, very wealthy. And we're given this little glimpse into heaven where the devil says to God, now you see that guy, that Job, you know, it's covered love. If you take away all his riches and all his blessings, he'll curse you. God says, right, you're on. It's just what I'll do. So God allows all his riches to be taken away. He allows his children to be killed. And he allows his Job's health to disintegrate. But Job remains faithful. He has three friends who come along to comfort him. And they basically, because they see Job suffering, They're convinced that he's done something wrong, so they try to convince him that he's a sinner. Job, of course, tries to defend himself. Eventually, God settles the argument, and basically what he says is, yes, Job is a sinner, but that's not why he was punished. He wasn't punished directly for any sin that he had done. And that gives us an insight into suffering. You don't necessarily suffer because you've done bad. I mean, logically, if that were the case, if you suffered because you'd done something evil, there would be no such thing as a serial killer. Once you've committed the first murder, here we go, zap, thunderbolt, and that would be it. But we all know that's not how it works. And we all know that good people sometimes do not prosper. Wicked people sometimes do. Well, the Book of Job tackles that question and this whole idea that you can be righteous in your own strength. Answer, no, not really. It's not going to work that way. Right, moving on, we have the Book of Psalms. Now, I mentioned David. David wrote about probably half of the Psalms. His son Solomon did a fair number, and a musician called Asaph. And there are 150 Psalms, slap in the middle of the Bible. They're the hymns of the day. We've lost the tunes for the most part. The one that survives actually suggests that that's quite a good thing that we've lost the tunes. The tune for it is absolutely dire. But people like myself, as I say, rewrite new tunes and set the old ones to contemporary music. We then have the Book of Proverbs, which is really hard going to read. You have to read it in small sections. It's hundreds of little proverbs and sayings, all of which are quite wise, and they're roughly wee mottos that you might just like to memorise a few from. Then the Book of Ecclesiastes, written by Solomon, King David's surviving son. He had lots of sons, and they all got killed, they all got murdered by one of their brothers, who then himself got killed in battle. Solomon survived, and he wrote this Book of Ecclesiastes. And Solomon started well, and then kind of lost the plot. And the book is very much, oh woe is me, what's the point? He was a manic depressive, and no mistake. It is, however, beautifully written. It's lovely, lovely literature. Pleasure to read. Next comes the Song of Songs, again written by Solomon. Yes. It's an erotic love poem, and it's been watered down for the good book here. Some of the stuff would have made your granny have a convies. Why it's there, I don't know. I'm hoping I'll discover someday, but at the moment I'm clueless as to why it's included. But next we move on to the prophets. Now the prophets were the guys that throughout the reigns of all the kings that were mentioned earlier, were saying to these kings, wait a minute, you can't do that. It'll end up as a disaster. Prophecy is as much about telling people what they should be doing as it is about predicting the future. Actually, only a quarter of it is about predicting the future. The bulk of it is telling folk how they should live. And we have Isaiah, Jeremiah, another second book with Jeremiah called Lamentations, which, as you can tell from the titles, not much in the way of laughs in it. Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, of Jonah and the Whale story, Micah, Nahum, goodness, thanks for peanuts, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and lastly, Malachi. And then, as I said earlier, there was a 400-year silence. No prophets appeared in Israel for 400 years. We then move into the New Testament part of the book. And that starts with the four Gospels, which are the accounts of Jesus' life. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, they tell, by and large, the same stories. Sometimes there's kind of different different viewpoint. As you would expect from four witnesses to an accident, they're all going to tell you something slightly different, aren't they? It's not going to all match up completely. If it did all match up completely, as Mr. Policeman, you would start to suspect something is not right. You expect to find the errors. That's what you do, or discrepancies in the Gospels. Partly it's due to the fact that they're writing for different audiences. Matthew is writing for the Jewish community. Mark is telling Peter's story, because Mark is Peter's nephew. Luke is writing for the Greek community, who are not really interested in Jewish lineage and stuff like that. More on logical things. And John is writing from personal experience. He was the one that was actually there. He was young John the disciple, who was only a teenager when the events took place, and is writing as an old man when he's processed the whole thing. He's thought it through, he's seen the implications, he's seen how it's paid out, and therefore his gospel is a much more informed viewpoint than the other three, who also, incidentally, the other three also have a common source, gospel Q. I don't know who wrote it, and it's been lost, but it's as if that they all quote it in wee bits. It counts for similarities in the theory. Luke also wrote the next book, which is the Book of Acts, which is basically just telling the start-up of the church, Pentecost, the coming of the Holy Spirit, which is vital if you are a believer. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, then this is like getting an email with a wrong program. You can't open it, you won't understand it. That's why atheists cannot understand this book. They don't have the key to it. The key is the Spirit. You get the Holy Spirit by believing in Jesus, by trusting, yes, getting back to the old trusting God. You will receive the Holy Spirit. After that, your eyes are opened, and it's a doddle from there. Acts introduces us to a character called Paul, who was a persecutor of the church. He was very high up in the Jewish community, powerful, well thought of, well educated, brain the size of a planet. But he got converted on Damascus Road. The Lord appeared to him, and that was it. His eyes were opened. Now, he writes quite a few of the next books. They're all really in the form of letters to churches. The first one is Romans. Romans is the one that you really want to read, because he's writing to people that he's never met. Therefore, he's covering all the important stuff. He makes sure he gets it all in there. Well worth a read. If you read nothing else, read Romans. We then have 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. And these are all like conversations. In each case, there's been some sort of problem in the church community, and he's addressing the problem in his letters, and sometimes it takes two letters to get it all sorted out, and we have to read between the lines to figure out sometimes what the actual initial problem was. But there's a lot of important stuff bubbles up while you're reading it. First and Second Timothy is writing to a young guy that he had educated and who was trying to spread the gospel, and the letters of encouragement, which are very good. Then there are Titus and Philemon, all kind of centering on a slave, the return of a slave who has become a Christian, to a slave owner who has become a Christian. How do you sort that one out? Whole new relationship with that. Right, that's what they're about. Then we have one of the books in the New Testament. We don't know who actually wrote it. It's the book of Hebrews. It's all about faith. It's very encouraging, and it's a good book to read. But as I say, lots of people argue about who wrote it. It wasn't Paul, because it's not his style of writing. Simple as that. It's just not Paul's style, so I know it wasn't him. Then some of the other disciples get a look in. We have a letter from James, who was the brother of Jesus. I'll say that again. James, who was the brother of Jesus. Jesus had brothers and sisters. Read the book, read the Gospels. Matthew, Mark and Luke. You'll find it in there. We even know the names of his brothers. Don't know the names of his sisters, but it's plural. More than one. Now, they weren't obviously miraculous births. They were perfectly natural children of Joseph and Mary. That's James. We move on to 1 and 2 Peter. Again, letters to two churches addressing problems, clearing things up. And then we have letters from John again. Probably the same John. There's some dispute, may have been another John. But it seems like the same guy that was with Jesus and that wrote Revelations. And he has to take three goes at getting some particular problem sorted out. He keeps having to refine his answers because he keeps getting these questions shot back at him again. Then we have the Book of Jude. It's only a page and it's weird and it's all about angels and demons arguing over the body of Moses. Moses' soul. Weird. But it's there for a purpose. You've got to figure it out. Lastly, we come to the Book of Revelations. Now, Revelations was written by the aforesaid John the disciple, and written when he was an old man and a prisoner for preaching the gospel. He'd been imprisoned on an island called Patmos. It starts off with seven short letters, just about half a page each, to seven churches in the province of Asia, which is today's Turkey, Syria, Lebanon areas. And although they are specific to each church in the century in which they were written, they seem to have a kind of comment to the church over the centuries. You know, in such and such a century, that was a problem. And 200 or 300 years later, this was the problem that we all had. They seem to have a kind of ongoing relevance, shall we say, as does much of the rest of Revelations. Yes, there are prophecies about the end times and the future in it, but a lot of it is just the ongoing situation. There's war, there's famine, there's pestilence. Well, yes, there have been these things since the dawn of time, and will be until the end. It's like a glimpse from the throne room of heaven, an overview, looking down at the map of the world at all times and all ages. A comment on that. It's also a book with a blessing, if you read it. Right, so that's the Bible. And what it really tells us is that we started with trust being broken. And what is wanted is that trust to be restored. By putting your faith in Jesus, he'll pay for your sins, past, present, and future if necessary, although do try not to. Do that and you're okay. Ignore this book. You stand in your own righteousness. How shaky, isn't it?